This is the lecture covering the basics of pharmacology, part two. In this section, we're going to review drug actions and effects. Drugs are eliminated from the body by metabolism and excretion. A measure of time required for elimination is called half-life. Half-life is defined as the time it takes for 50% of the drug to be eliminated from the body. An example of half-life would be if you would give 100 milligrams of medication at noon on Monday, of a medication that has a half-life of 12 hours. But 12 hours later at midnight on Monday, 50 milligrams of that medication is still available in the bloodstream. At noon on Tuesday, 25 milligrams is still in the system, and so on. As you can imagine, a medication with a long half-life will need to be taken less frequently. This is an important consideration with our geriatric population, especially when we consider medications like diazepam or Valium that cause sedation and have a long half-life. All drugs have an onset, peak, and duration. Onset is when the drug has arrived to the target spot and the concentration of the medication is enough to start a response. Peak is the time when the drug reaches its height concentration on the target receptor sites. Duration is how long the drug has pharmacological effect. It's also crucial as allied health professionals to know the desired action and side effects of each medication prior to administration and the antidote if one is available. The goal for medication administration is to reach a therapeutic level. A drug's therapeutic level or therapeutic effect is the desired effect for treating a disease or a symptom, while a drug's side effect is an undesired effect on the patient. When a drug is in the bloodstream, sometimes a blood sample may be drawn to determine the amount of drug in the system. It's important that certain drugs like antibiotics and anticonvulsants be measured to ensure that the drug blood level is within the therapeutic range. If our drug level is too low, it doesn't work. If it's too high, toxicity can occur. Medications may become toxic and cause permanent damage. Ototoxicity is quite simply ear poisoning, which may be the result from exposure to drugs. Such damage can lead to temporary or permanent hearing loss and/or loss of balance. The antibiotic gentamicin is one of these drugs that can cause ototoxicity. Patients can complain of hearing loss, vertigo or dizziness, and tinnitus or ringing in the ears. Other medications like non-steroidal analgesics like ibuprofen or Motrin can cause nephrotoxicity and damage kidney function. If kidney damage is suspected, we can monitor blood tests such as the BUN or blood urea nitrogen to evaluate kidney function. Here's an interesting fact. Did you know that the ears and the kidneys are derived from the same tissue during fetal formation? So, this is why some medications may be ototoxic and nephrotoxic. You know, other medications can be toxic to the liver, which is hepatotoxicity. Jaundice or yellowing of the skin and eyes may be seen. When a medication is approved and goes on the market, the drug manufacturer has to list all its known side effects. You know, every medication has side effects, and these are usually mild and allows the patient to continue taking the medication. Nausea, vomiting, and constipation are examples of this. Many times we can work with these side effects by changes to the diet or activity. I have had patients, though, who stated they were allergic to medications, and when I asked them, they said it made them nauseated. Nausea is not an allergic response, side effect. Okay, on the other hand, now we have adverse reactions, and these are severe side effects, such as death or shock. The physician will certainly change the medication in this instance. You might note that in some of your nursing drug books, the common side effects will be underlined and the adverse effects will be in red. At times, a patient will have an idiosyncratic reaction or a rare and unique side effect. This effect must also be managed. Allergic reactions or hypersensitivities can occur with patients and can cause urticaria or hives. If this reaction is mild, the patient is warned to not take this medication again. Occasionally, though, a patient can have a life-threatening reaction that causes respiratory distress and cardiovascular collapse. This is known as an anaphylactic reaction and is a medical emergency. Patients are warned to tell all healthcare practitioners about this and wear a medical alert bracelet that explains this allergy. So let's briefly look at the systems and the kind of side effects that we might see with our body systems. So when a medication affects the nervous system, again, we must watch for serious side effects. Side effects can include agitation, confusion, delirium, depression, drowsiness, decreased respiration, and coma. As we discussed earlier, the liver is one of the major organs that metabolizes medications. If drugs accumulate in the liver, it can cause permanent damage. Acetaminophen, or Tylenol is its brand name, is one such drug. Liver damage is the most serious side effect of acetaminophen, and it can be fatal. Here's how it goes. Acetaminophen is broken down in the liver, and it creates several byproducts. These byproducts hurt us, but if the acetaminophen builds up in the liver, the pathway that eliminates these byproducts is overloaded, and the liver must use another path to remove them. When this happens, a toxic compound called NAPQI is made, and this is what causes liver damage. You know, the GI system suffers probably the most from medications. Many medications can cause nausea and vomiting. For some reasons, it could be that medications irritate the stomach. They can affect the inner ear. They may cause dizziness, and this can cause nausea. They may also slow down intestinal movement and make you feel bloated and sick to your stomach. Many times we can work with these symptoms depending on the medication. Other GI symptoms are, of course, vomiting, anorexia, diarrhea, constipation, and stomach ulcers. Some medications affect the urinary system, especially our diuretics, commonly known as water pills. Fluid and electrolyte imbalances may occur, so those do need to be monitored. Certain drugs can also affect the hematology system and cause problems with poor coagulation of blood, bleeding, clotting, and immunosuppression. Side effects may be decreased red blood cells, white blood cells, and platelets. With a decrease in red blood cells, the patient will become anemic, leading to fatigue and weakness. A decrease in white blood cells can make the patient prone to infections. With decreased platelets, control of bleeding can be challenging. You know, some medications such as Urinary, Coumadin is the brand name. These medications are designed to decrease clotting, so blood levels have to be done to evaluate clotting routinely. The key to pharmacology is to get the most effective medication with the least amount of problems. We must understand these medications that we administer and their possible effects, good and bad. Before we give medications, assessment of the patient is necessary to obtain baseline data. Assessing the blood work and vital signs may be necessary prior to administration. We, as healthcare professionals, we must be really vigilant about knowing how to best administer a drug for proper absorption into the blood. We should also know where the drug is distributed and what symptoms or lab test results to watch for that may show a potential problem. Understanding how drugs are excreted and the chance of accumulation is also critical. You know, we are the patient's advocate. This concludes part two of Basics of Pharmacology. If you have any questions, bring them to the Pharm Cafe or to the classroom.